Welcome to OCD, Obsessive Consumer Disorder. A series that talks about the myriad lives of partners, promoters from the agency, event, media and entertainment, and consumer product space. We are here to find out what makes our hearts tick and why we pursue what we think is a promising career. Possibly also answer some of the common problems we have together. I'm very, very happy to have Niranjan Pagadala on this first episode of this series. A friend and a brother who has had an illustrious career in sports, media and entertainment, and today is rigging it with the agency life. Niranjan, very nice to have you on this show.
Thank you, and feels really good to again sort of come on board with you on this platform. We've had a lot of partnerships on the cricketing field, batted in a number of matches, had long partnerships, and I think having both of us sit here and chat about a completely different field feels really good.
Those are some memorable times.
Absolutely.
But things have changed a lot since then, haven't they?
Yeah. Like any other field, I think things in the world across the globe are moving faster than ever before. That's happened in the field of cricket as well.
So tell me, what has changed from the time when you started, moving out of cricket, but what has changed from then to the time you got into media and entertainment and then you moved on, in fact, even a little bit of celebrity management and sports management, and then you moved into the agency life. So why did you get here?
So sport is something that I'd encourage all of you to, do. That's what has helped me leaps and bounds to reach wherever I have, much more than my education. Of course, I didn't go enough to school and college because of my cricketing career. But what sports taught me is something that nothing else can. Yeah. The sort of pressure situations, the challenges that we face, the spirit of winning as a team.
At some level, I think it's very important that we learn to lose at a very early age.
Yeah.
We understand that winning and losing is part of life.
Yes.
But what's important is to make the effort to set yourself up at the best possible competency.
Absolutely. In sport, you will have more failures than, winning moments. In terms of doing well, it's not going to be easy, right? Even you take the best of players.
Yeah.
The number of innings that they would have scored 100 or 50 will be far lesser than the number of innings they failed. So just imagine what they have to go through.
So basically, at some level, I think it eradicates the fear of failure.
Yeah, absolutely. And, it tells you how to react to failure and then come out of it as a winner.
Yeah.
So I think going through that whole journey taught me a lot of things.
Very nice.
And then again, at the age of 24, while I was playing Ranji, I had a back injury, I had to step out of sport.
Yeah.
It was a tough decision for me. And then I had worked with Mahesh Bhupathi, the tennis player, again, an association with sport. He has a sports. And then I suddenly saw that this league was coming up with film stars.
Yeah.
And I thought, if I can get my cricketing experience and expertise on the management front as well onto this field, I think it would be a great combination. And that's when I just walked into their office.
Right.
The founder Vishnu Induri, and I just presented, I told him this is what I can do. And he also, being the entrepreneur that he is, he takes decisions quickly, and if he believes in something, he moves forward. He said, why don't you join me from tomorrow? And that's how that all started. I never wanted to join a big company because I'm going to be a small fish in a sea.
You get lost in the pile of...
Yeah. And the role that I'll be given will be limited. Yeah. When I spoke to my friends, they didn't even know what product they were actually working on. So I didn't want to do that. I was very clear that I wanted to learn. Every day till date has to be exciting for me. And it has been. And then I started, I decided that I will join a company that's just starting up and see where I can take it. And that's where I got experience across marketing, legal, operations, all of the
legal, because there's a lot of contract work with all of these people.
Yeah, and
also there was a lot of liaisoning with departments of different states,
right,
etc.
Right. And I have
different countries. I think you also travel to the Middle East sometimes.
Yeah. And when I say legal, right, it's not just the legal side of it per se, but it's also about, I was involved in raising funds. We raised over 5 million in one round, and I was I played a key role in that, and I experienced a lot of good things in smaller companies. Then I moved to country one. I was very, very clear that I wanted to get into the internet space.
Right.
It just amazes me how you can sit anywhere in the globe and just change things anywhere in the globe. So that's what fascinates me till today.
So what are your learnings from being at FCCL, and what do you take away from that gig before you
move? So the events industry in Hyderabad is very unorganized. Not just Hyderabad, I think in India it's very unorganized. Yeah. But the best part about India is we manage and we get things done.
Yeah.
The moment you go out of India, you go into more countries like the US, it's not very easy to get things done in the last minute.
They are way too structured and planned for their own good.
Yes, and they have the bandwidth.
So I think there's a sense of chaos that sets in for them when things don't go according to plan. Whereas here, I think it's a normal sense of being.
Like yes, absolutely.
Every other day, we wake up to challenges.
Right.
And I'm not saying that is good or bad, but I'm saying there is definitely an ability that's been built in people like us, who are raised where we are,
right,
to confront these challenges head on,
yeah,
and sort of see them through on the other side.
Yeah.
Successfully or not doesn't matter.
Yeah.
But it's important to see them through.
Yeah.
So you're saying that had a major sort of impact on you when you're doing events.
I'll just give you one incident. For example, we were playing, Karnataka was playing the Telugu team.
Yeah.
Again, they're all celebrities.
Yeah.
Handling one celebrity, you would have known how difficult it is. We had to handle 100 of some of the best celebrities across the country. And
for a period of 30-40 days,
day in
and day out.
Absolutely. And then during the game, one floodlight went off. That whole tower, went off. But we had enough light for the batsman to see the ball at that pace and play. But then he said, I can't play, I can't see the ball properly, and he wanted us to fix it. When I ran out and asked this guy, why did this light go off? Because we have generators as backups.
Yeah, yeah.
Then my vendor tells me that he wanted to save money for me on that diesel, and he didn't put a backup. These sort of things, I don't have answers to, and these are situations we have to face. We had to fix it.
That's
in the next
too much
10
of
minutes.
A challenge to confront.
Yeah.
So especially when you're in the middle of things. And
right, and these are normal. These happen every other day. We get calls at 3 in the morning saying we need 60 cabs the next day by 6 a.m. in a place like Vizag, where we've already booked all the cars in the city. So these sort of situations put us under so much pressure and stress that if you come out as a winner from that, you'll be able to do anything.
So did you hang your shoes up saying good riddance to the chaos? Because I'm assuming the internet space is way more planned.
Yeah, so till the time I was there, the 3 years I was in CCL, I was there, things were good, and I came out. We successfully had 4 seasons, and then that's when I came out and moved into the internet.
Probably had a moment to breathe once you were out.
Yeah. Then I moved into Country Oven.
Yeah.
There was one of my mentors, Karthik Polsani. He told me that, why don't you come and look at this brand, which is again an SME, but has been there in the internet space for a long time.
Yeah.
So I was keen. I thought, yes, I can build the team from here and see how
they're
it goes.
In fact one of the first people to get onto online delivery,
right.
Back in the 90s.
Correct. Again, the same challenges to face with, but it was not too difficult for me because for me the subject was a sort of new.
Yeah.
Something that I was interested in, but didn't have enough skill and knowledge about it. So that's what I started learning, build the team. And in 1.5 years, with barely any increase in ad expenditure, we were able to increase the business by 2.5 times. Then I thought, this works.
And then you realize the power of the medium.
And a lot of people in India are not doing it because honestly, it was not too difficult for me if I did the right things. Then I went to my dad. My dad is an ENT specialist, and I started optimizing his page. Till today, I have not spent a rupee on marketing for him. It's just a little bit of my time. Yeah. And he ranks amongst the best on Google. His patients have increased by 4 times in 2 years. Then I thought there's something in here.
Yeah.
That's when my childhood friend, we went to school from grade 1, Sriram, I met him. And 6 months before I came out of Country Oven, he also said that, he was keen, and we both thought at some point we should start something together.
What was Sriram doing? How did you guys?
He was in the US, and then he also started working with a startup in Singapore. We were in constant touch of wanting to do something together. We didn't know what. I knew that I had to be in the internet space. Then he came back and he joined his family business, which was in construction, again, a completely different field.
Yeah.
So for 6 months, we both got together, and he sort of worked with me.
So you were incubating a thought and an idea of wanting to be in the space, but not really sure how to start.
Yes, right. We were sure how that and where the to space start, we want to take. And then that's how it all started. We wanted to build a product, but we knew that if we had to build a product, we needed enough funds. We were very clear. We didn't want to take funding from the beginning. We don't believe in that concept till we reach a certain stage. So then he and me are completely different personalities. I think I sort of try and do more research, strategy, then take a decision. He's more go with the flow and
But he's the backbone of the organization today, right? And what he does is essentially runs the operations for you.
Yeah.
While so you're the one who's doing the strategy piece and who's trying to figure out where to take the organization, he's the one who's actually running the ops day to day?
Yeah, right. So we've identified our strengths in these 3 years, and then we've clearly segregated our roles. Now today we are a team of close to 60, and we have leaders for different verticals.
Right.
And then the main reason, so we wanted to start a product, and then we said we didn't have that many funds, that much of a fund to start a product.
Right away.
We thought we are good at marketing. Why don't we try and start this? And then eventually look to build products that fit into these services. Yeah. And then we wanted to test ourselves.
Are
we
but really was that always the idea? Was the idea always to start the service end of things and then get into building products which actually fit the services? Or did you have a product philosophy when you started? Did you know what kind of product you were going out there to make?
No. We knew that we were going to start a service and then build a product. Okay. Till today, we are on the same path, and we've been decently successful in that direction. We will continue to move in that direction.
Okay.
And we were very, very clear, the idea of building the product must come in through consumer insights and not through our own ideation.
Okay. So this helped.
Yeah.
Being in the service space helped you understand the consumer better, and eventually you built a product around, you know, your learnings. So what have been the startling learnings about consumers, since the show is all about, you know, why we are in this space and why we're doing what we're doing. And you've journeyed with, you know, consumers at a CCL scale.
Right.
People coming in, flocking the crowd, flocking the stadium to watch the game, you know, and people following celebrities on social. And now you're actually trying to sell to the same consumer as an relatively unknown brand or a decently known brand. You know, why are you in this space? What do you learn about consumers? What have you learned about consumers?
So with consumers, What the gap I see a lot of times is that what happens in a discussion room between five or six people in terms of building strategy without data and research results in what is actually not required by the consumer. You know, when five or six of us say in our office, five or six of us get together when a new brand is on board, a new industry, and we try and come up with some plans and make some assumptions about what the consumer is, or we go based on some study.
And I think that is the death knell. The moment we start thinking the consumer of this product is us, or the moment we start making assumptions about why this consumer is purchasing or not purchasing, or sort of even preferring or not preferring this brand, that is the death knell.
Right.
That is where we need to stop that kind of activity and probably get into more of a research-oriented mode.
Research and communicate with the customer. Talk to the customer. Talk to 10 or 15 people, you'll know a trend. You don't have to talk to 500 people.
Yeah.
You talk to 15 core potential customers or existing customers, and you will begin to get a trend.
Right.
And then you start sit and ideate.
Right.
The idea might be great. The idea might be extremely creative. But if you're not giving consumers what they're looking for, then it's not going to work. Say, for example, in real estate, we've seen time and again that you give a crazily creative campaign versus another campaign that just tells you location, price, square feet, and the critical details. We've often seen that the one that gives you the details that are required for the customer has performed far better than something that's very creative.
That's storytelling, etc., but not essentially delivering on the foundation.
So unless you talk to the customers and see data firsthand, not something from some other research, but unless you see that firsthand and then start creating tests.
So Niranjan, tell me, when you started 8Views, did you already have a model for how a digital agency of today should function, or did this evolve as you were working with Sriram together? So as you were also trying to understand the market, the customer, the consumer, and finally, you know, your own people.
So there were a few very strong findings that I believe in today. The way most of India operates in digital, the way most of India learns digital is not right. See, digital marketing is like software.
Mm.
You know, it's like IT. You have to learn the art. You have to learn. There are specializations within it.
Mm.
Right? But what's happening is with institutes in India, it's still not structured properly. They're teaching the whole of digital marketing in 45 days, 30 days, give them a course, and people come out as digital marketing managers.
So those guys are just riding the wave because there are people who are interested in being in digital, and they just happen, it's just an opportune moment.
Yeah,
and you come up with like putting together some kind of a faculty which might or might not have industry and consumer relevance, but you just dole out series of sort of modules which make a curriculum which basically talk about the AdWords and, you know, sort of the Google space, and then also talk about social space, and that they sort of cap it with a certificate and say you're certified now to be a digital marketer.
Yeah, so
but that's not the essence of it.
That's not the real game. Like, you feel really good that you know everything,
yeah,
but then what impact are you able to have on the growth of a business?
what is the market doing to them? Are they just scraping the surface? They know a little bit of everything, but they don't know anything in depth. Is that the challenge?
Yes. So from the beginning, it's very difficult for me to hire somebody like that.
Yeah.
Right. So the reason our company is called 8views is because we have 8 verticals and we have specialists under each vertical.
Right.
So a guy who's running ads, he is not doing SEO or he's not writing content. You have writers for writing content. You have designers. You have a video team. You have a guy who runs campaigns every day. His job is to just optimize campaigns. And trust me, it'll take you more than a lifetime to master the art of ads across platforms.
Right.
Now, if you're bringing in SEO and different things into that guy's profile, he's not going to deliver.
Right.
And in the end, we were very clear, even till today, that 8views is launched to help a business meet its business goals, whether it be revenue, whether it be signups, whatever that is. From the day one, even when we pitch, we are talking about how can we get to your business goals.
So have you put together a signature process, a process that you at 8views follow as a team, or is it very, very versatile? Is it completely based on the challenge that's been presented to you?
No, I try and create as many static elements as possible in the company.
Right.
So you have creative. Creative is always dynamic. I can't tell that a creative should be like this.
Right.
But I can tell tech that I need my product like this.
Yeah.
I can tell my campaigns team that I need campaigns to perform like this. These are the numbers that we need to achieve. I can't do that with creative.
Yeah.
So the tech and campaigns teams, marketing teams are aligned very well in a process. Yeah. And the creative team is also within a process, but they have their entire creative freedom to be able to do what they want. I never get into micromanagement, but I'm very, very particular about being able to automate and create processes. So you have to take a decision if you want to be a company that is 10, 20 people, or you want to scale this up to a lot more.
Yeah.
And beyond 50, 60, 70, I have not really looked to grow in people after 50. I'm trying and improving the quality of the team. But what I'm trying to bring in is more of tech, more of automation, because in the same time, if I can service more brands and deliver better results, that's the ultimate thing, right?
Yeah.
And then I can be very competitive with price as well. Yeah. And the brand values me a lot because I'm directly connected to his business. If he leaves me, then his revenues may be...
Revenue might drop, or whatever his metric is for judging your performance might just go out the window.
Right. So why does somebody start a business? They want to make money.
Yeah.
Now, if I'm in that game of them making money and I'm a decent contributor in that, then it's difficult for him to leave.
Then you have an important seat on the table.
Right.
And it's very difficult for him to get rid of you.
Right. Right.
But tell me a little bit about the marketplace. How well does the marketplace understand the consumer? I'm not saying we're the gurus of consumerism and we understand consumers, every other consumer on the street, but we at least make a sincere and honest effort to. But you might be running into challenges when you talk to the market. And when I say market, I specifically mean your clients from different verticals. How would you rate their understanding and their appetite and their aptitude today?
So there is a big gap between the client's understanding and the agency's point of view. Yeah. And you'll always see that each of them will complain about each other. In the end, even if you go and sit on the client's seat, or even if I go and I'll probably behave like that.
So, yeah, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I've journeyed through the phase where I complained about clients, and now I don't complain about them anymore. I see them as human beings who have insecurities, who have pitfalls, and they're just very normal people. And I think if we have to be larger as an agency, as a partner, we need to have a larger heart and we need to have a broader view of things. And sometimes they might just press the panic button, and we should know how to deal with that situation.
Right.
And it's very, very, very important on our part to have exercise some kind of, I would like to call it, empathy towards what they're feeling. Because I know that these are the guys who are paying out of their pockets. When they start out, at least expecting miracles to happen. But eventually, I think expectations are set. And they fall into this thing where they know what to expect from us. And at that point, I think that is a point where we need to nurture it very, very carefully. So complaining about clients is something that's out the window for me right now. And I'm trying to bring that kind of a culture within the organization.
So, but on that aspect, when I dug deeper, I found one big difference.
Right.
The client does not come with a creative background.
Yeah.
He's not a designer. He's not a writer.
He's not a marketer. He's not even a marketer.
He's not a marketer.
Yeah.
And the guy who's at the agency is a creative guy or he's a marketer.
Yeah.
So these, both of their thoughts are never anyway, going to be aligned fully.
They start on a collision course.
Yeah. And this guy is a business guy.
Yeah.
And the guy at the agency is not a business guy.
Yeah.
He wouldn't be able to understand the client's business aspects as much as this guy does.
Yeah.
So when that gap is very difficult to close. So more and more what we try and do is try and educate both of them on each other's fields.
Right.
While we may not be able to do it fully, we can make the situation better. And if as an agency, if you're able to understand his business need better, then all of these problems, I think most of them can be ironed out in a much better way.
It's all about the last man, right? So it's very important for somebody who's in your team, who's handling that business, the last person on the team, the person that whose opinion you think doesn't count. It's very important that they actually have full knowledge of the business. And getting organizations to function like that probably is one of the toughest things to do.
Yeah, we can try and push towards that, but that's never going to happen.
Yeah, the reality is it's never going to happen.
Yeah, it's never going to happen, and that's the fact. But what we try and do is when a brand comes on board, we create a master document where we document all of these things and circulate internally. And then, hopefully he has a decent understanding before he starts working on it.
Yeah.
But things like every single person working on the brand should take ownership of the brand or knowing entirely about the business of the brand is not happening.
So I think the thing is to stick with it,
Emphasize
on it enough for people to understand that there is some serious intent from the organization to ensure that they know why they're doing what they're doing.
Right.
And I'm sure somewhere down the line, we'll all figure out an answer to that.
Yeah.
So tell me about some of your most interesting gigs. What has been, as 8 years, Shriram and you and the team, what have you been doing and what has been really standing out as a piece of work?
Like I said, for us, we get immense happiness when we are able to really drive growth for a business, right? It could be across any vertical. Say, for example, there's a school in Dilshuk Nagar called Sanskriti.
Yeah.
And that school had 600 kids.
Yeah.
And we didn't know if digital is going to work in an area like Dilshuk Nagar, which is not known for having a large base of internet users. Or people who actually engage on social media. To our surprise, that worked even better than what it did in an area like Gachibowli.
And why do you think that is?
Is it
that the school is an area of interest, education is an area of interest?
No.
Or is it because the consumer there surprised you?
The competition is very low. The exposure to all of this for people there was very low.
Right.
Once we started doing some decent work on the digital front for this brand, they started to react very positively.
Right.
And in 2 years from 600 kids, they've come to 1250 kids and they've opened a new school.
Yeah.
So, I mean, nothing can give us more joy than that.
Right.
And there's another brand called Oi Happy on the e-commerce front.
They're into gifting. And events.
Yeah. And so they're into gifting, primarily an e-commerce gifting store. And they said, when they came on board, they said, how much should we increase our ad spend by and stuff like that. I said, don't increase your ad spend. Let me see what value I can provide to you. So with the same ad spend, we were able to increase their business by over 50% in the first 4 months.
Right.
That was the joy that we got out of that.
Yeah.
Not too many things can beat that in terms of delivering results. So our constant goal is if it's a real estate player, how many flats can we help you sell? How many walk-ins can we bring you? For education, how many admissions can we get you? How can we position your brand?
So you've basically rubbed off all of this energy into the team. And they understand it's not about the paraphernalia of how you are communicating. It's more about understanding the essence of why we are in this engagement and getting these numbers happening, no matter what it sort of comes our way.
From the beginning, we've seen also that the brands for whom we've been able to deliver results have hung on to us for a longer
time. And it probably has a lot to do with the team being aligned to what you're trying to
do. Yeah, it has to be.
And that energy should be flowing all the way down.
100%.
Where the objective of what you're doing is very, very clear.
So what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to take the creative aspect of it, which is usually very heavy in most companies. I take the creative aspect
of it. Tone it down a little bit.
Yeah, tone it down because of the involvement of tech and marketing.
Yeah.
I try and bring this together, try and bring decent work together to deliver a business result.
Nice.
Once we've done that successfully, it's going to be very hard for a brand to leave us.
It's really nice to know about these little wins which you value.
Yeah.
It's not always the big things.
Right.
Sometimes the little things that you do that work and you get surprised with stay with you for a much longer time.
Yeah.
You were talking about a product you're working on. What is the product today? I mean, where has it evolved? Which category are you actually focusing on?
So when we started 8views, we said we want to grow your business. And then we started running campaigns. We started doing different things on digital.
Yeah.
But then these guys say, take for example, a real estate client came and told me, okay, you're doing all of this. How many flats am I selling? And how do I know it's from you?
Yeah.
So I saw that creative companies do some really good work and probably sold a lot of flats for them, but you can't.
But you cannot attribute that to their work.
To this. It is required, but you can't attribute. The advantage on digital.
So you need to build a framework or a foundation where people can say this is because of them.
Yes.
And that is something you set out to do.
Yeah, that's something I set out to do, and that's when we started our own product line called GrowthEye. GrowthEye.com is the website. So there, what we started doing is all the inquiries that come in from Facebook, Instagram, from LinkedIn, from website, email, phone calls, all of this come and fall into that system.
Yeah.
And then we started creating notifications for them. We started doing some really good stuff that made them call a lead back within 5 minutes. Imagine that you inquire for a school or a real estate property.
But this is something typically that's not in your control. That's something on the client's end, right? So did you actually...
We push them and we let the management know that your sales guy is not calling
responding.
Or not calling. Right? Because our campaigns guy needs to see that every day and needs to see the quality of...
So you have a guy who monitors whether we have returned people's calls answered queries.
Yeah, the campaigns team and the account managers do that.
So you're milking it to the last mile.
Yeah, yeah. And unless I know that unless their
that happens,
business is growing,
yeah.
I'm not really impacting...
And I think unless that happens, it can never get attributed to you.
It can't.
You never
know
whether that lead has converted because of you or not. And you don't want to waste a lead that you've generated. GrowthEye is basically a platform which is helping people look at like a dashboard, which is more of a lead generation funnel.
Right.
So have you put together some off-the-shelf technologies and created your own UI? And
Yeah. This is all created on our own. We use different APIs. Yeah. The second tool that we are creating now is, say for example, you take Facebook. You make a great creative, you post it, it doesn't go to people.
Yeah.
That's how Facebook works today.
Because the algorithms are very complex.
Algorithms are like that. There's so many brands that have come.
It's a capital market. So
yeah.
They're doing
they're
doing.
Yeah. So this needs to be taken. Every post is valuable. Needs to be taken and promoted to the right set of people.
Yeah.
Now, if I tell my campaigns guy to do that every day, it's a very boring job for him. And eventually, he doesn't do it.
Yeah.
Right. So we
somewhere
decided,
the interest wanes off and he's off. He's not doing it anymore.
Yeah. So what GrowthEye campaigns will do is you can set out a rule saying that I want to promote a post that had 5 likes in the first 3 hours to an audience who liked my page and are using an iPhone 6.
Right.
Spend 500 rupees on that for 2 days.
Right.
And launch. Okay. So once I set up that rule.
Specifics.
Yeah. Once I set up that rule, every post that gets matches that metrics will be boosted.
So micro targeting.
Everything is taken care of. You already set it up.
Yeah.
And from a brand point of view, it's helping because it's reaching the right audience. You're continuously there in front of their eye.
And also to some extent, you're actually getting the human intervention out of it.
Yes.
And
it's
making
completely
sure
automated.
Multiple things are happening accurately.
Right.
Multiple campaigns are running accurately to different audience sets.
Right.
And this is something that was very difficult to do without a horde of people.
Yes.
And now you're able.
How India is doing it. I mean, I don't know anybody else who's building this tool, but if you're able to do this successfully, then we'll probably be one of the first in India.
Yeah, they are.
they're on the road. They're in the newspaper. They're on TV.
Right.
They're everywhere.
So they are there across different platforms.
But you don't get the right information.
You don't get information in one place. There are a few platforms, but there's a huge
So you want a snapshot.
Yeah.
And you don't get the snapshot.
Yeah, think of it like Zomato.
Yeah.
So we've started yellowslate.com.
It's Zomato for education.
Yes, for schools.
Okay.
And for the schools, we give them a backend system where they can run their school as well as manage the entire lead.
So where do you see 8views going? I mean, you've done so much. There are so many learnings, such interesting products that you're trying to develop. Apart from, of course, getting efficiencies with your service team and driving your energy all the way down to the last man.
Right.
Where do you see 8views going? What do you think you want to do with this entity?
So 8views, if you ask me in a line, I would define it as one place where you get creative marketing and technology at good quality. Hmm. That's something that's very, very difficult to find today.
Right.
Especially in the SME space.
Right.
Maybe there are large scale companies which have big
who are pulling it off at an MNC level with huge budgets.
Yeah. Where you have thousands of people. But
then there's the belt of India which actually runs India, which is the SME, MSME
exactly,
belt.
Exactly.
And they don't have a partner.
Right.
They don't have a quality partner.
Right.
And
so
that's what 8views is aspiring to be.
Right. So I will try and strengthen the static part, which is the tech and marketing. And I will continuously try to enhance the creative bit.
Right.
Through people, through again integrating whatever I can there. We've introduced video last year. That's been going very well.
Yeah.
We've been
Platforms are changing, algorithms are changing, videos are getting pushed.
I think
we have been cornered as agencies to ensure that we have that service.
Yeah. I think today without video is going to be very difficult because that content is performing. So might as well do it. The other one thing that I consciously don't do is I don't try and just follow the market and try and keep getting better at what the market offers. So
right.
there are these five parameters through which we compete with
right.
different companies.
Right.
But can I add parameter 6, 7, 8, 9,
yeah.
which others don't do
yeah.
or do it minimally? Like whatever I'm talking about growth, I,
yeah.
is that.
That is unique to you.
Yeah, unique to us.
Yeah, and that is something that also sort of is a feather in the hat.
Yeah.
When you're signing up a contract or when
right.
people are considering you for an engagement.
Yeah.
So 8views is trying to become like a formidable player in the SME, MSME space.
Yeah.
Marrying tech, creative and marketing.
Exactly.
And that's what you're aspiring to do.
Right.
It's yeah, nice to see that you're still connected to the game.
Yeah, that's something that I want to do always. So
yeah.
I always try and find purpose to my life.
Yeah.
What gives me the maximum joy.
Yeah.
And then I found that there was one incident that really, touched me. I was playing an under-22 game against Andhra, and there was this bowler who was bowling really well, and
yeah.
he had a torn shoe.
Yeah.
And then his name was Vijay Kumar.
Right.
I went and asked him after the game, why are you bowling with a torn shoe, you're bowling so well, and gave him a pair of shoes. I don't
right.
remember whether I gave him a kit or a pair of shoes.
Yeah.
And then I saw in a couple of years he was playing for Deccan Chargers.
Deccan Chargers, yeah.
And then I get to know that he's a lorry driver's son.
Yeah.
And then after a few more years, I see on his Facebook wall that he was donating, he was sponsoring some other kid.
Very nice.
And nothing gave me more joy than that.
So he paid it forward.
Yeah.
What he got from you, he translated that into a great career, and then he started helping people.
Yeah. And then I realized that this is what I want to do in life. So my eventual goal, along with driving my business parallelly, maybe with the business, we launch something that's going to help talent.
Yeah.
Not keep it open-ended and say I'll help everybody, but try and raise funds to help people who are talented, who have reached a certain level.
Mm.
For them to reach the highest level, they need certain funds or whatever help they need. We want to drive that, and that also through online.
So this is another journey that you're a part of.
Yeah.
It's
right now in a very
nascent stage
where I'm helping a few people, but I want to really structure this whole thing well.
So what I also always have wondered from the outside is, what is the culture that you're fostering at 8views, and what kind of initiatives are you taking to sort of differentiate yourself from any other workplace?
So from the beginning, what I always believed in is most of the world is unhappy wherever they work. They're unhappy because they're not doing what they like doing.
Yeah.
So one of the questions in my interview is, when you wake up in the morning, what will really motivate you to come to work? And if that answer matches the sort of role that we have, only then we take the interview forward.
Yeah.
That has ensured that majority of the people working
that come in itself go through a filtering process.
Yeah, are going to do what they like. Yeah. Once they are doing that, then the satisfaction levels are bound to be higher. Should really thank my team who supported me through this journey for the last 3.5 years. They mean a lot to me. And we have a lot of fun at office. We have a TT table, we have foosball table. So entertainment aspect is, we try and keep it
on
high.
All the time,
along with discipline at work. So
yeah.
Both these aspects are important. Every year, we take the team outside Hyderabad, to basically disconnect for a couple of days. Once
yeah.
within Hyderabad, we go out for a couple of days.
Yeah.
So all of this we do to really make sure, try and make sure the team is happy and keep trying to fix issues and gaps, because if they're not there, then you're not there. The team is pretty much everything that runs the company.
Nice to see that your heart is very much with your team.
Yeah.
And what they do at work every day.
Yeah, they mean everything to me and Sriram.
Catch us on another episode of Riveting Conversation on OCD, Obsessive Consumer Disorder. I am Gautam Reddy, signing off as your host on episode 1, debuting with my close friend Niranjan. Thank you, Niranjan.
Thanks for having me.